Welcome to Westover Air Force Reserve Base and the annual air show. The Great New England Air Show is what they're calling it. And we're going to take you on, well, on the flight line, which is exactly where we are right now. You're going to see an awful lot of aircraft today. We'll take you inside some of the major aircraft like the C-5A Galaxy. We're going to try to take you inside of some of the planes that are going to be involved in the acrobatics around here. The Flying Thunderbirds are going to be here later on, and we hope you stay around to watch this. If you're an air show enthusiast, you're just going to love this. Here at the Air Force Base in Westover, there are an awful lot of people here this morning as we get ready to take you through a whole day. And, of course, this whole day will be scoped into less than an hour, so you'll see the majority of the good things. There's a lot of other things you have to be down here yourself to experience, just the experience of being down here with all the aircraft. It's an absolutely amazing thing. If you missed it this year, you definitely have to come here next year. So why don't we start and take you around and show you some of the different planes that are in front of the hangars here on the flight line at Westover Air Reserve Base. Okay, our first plane on the flight line here at Westover is the AC-130H, and with me is Captain Craig Walker, who is going to tell us a little bit about the aircraft. Tell us about this baby.
This is the AC-130H Spectre gunship. It has three primary missions used in Air Force Special Operations Command. Primarily, we use it in the close air support role, interdiction, and armed reconnaissance. The aircraft has a history and a lineage dating back to Vietnam. And this particular aircraft has been in operations all the way up from Vietnam to Grenada, Somalia, Bosnia, Desert Storm. And currently we have two of these aircraft in Bosnia supporting all the operations that are going on.
Okay, and this particular aircraft goes back that far then?
Yes, in fact, this one on the side, if he wants to take a picture, you can see some of the operations that it's participated in.
How many people serve on this plane at one point? What's the crew?
The typical crew on this particular airplane is 14. We have two pilots, an engineer, a navigator, a fire control officer. We have an electronic warfare officer, two sensor operators, five gunners, and a loadmaster.
And where is this plane normally stationed out of?
We're stationed at Hurlburt Field, Florida, which is headquarters for Air Force Special Operations Command.
Thank you. Captain Craig Walker, thank you very much.
You bet.
Standing in front of the C-17A is Major Keith Gillette. Good morning.
Morning.
This is quite an aircraft. Tell us about the C-17.
Well, C-17 is the newest aircraft that the Air Force has for strategic and tactical airlift. And it's about 8 years old now. It's an incredible aircraft. Does everything that McDonnell Douglas ever said it could do, and actually even more. But extremely enjoyable airplane to fly, very challenging. And as probably many people noticed recently, we delivered the killer whale Kiko to Iceland a little while ago with this aircraft.
This type of aircraft is the one
from our base, Charleston Air Force Base, South Carolina.
That made the news. Old Kiko got good. Did he get a meal on board?
I don't know about the meal, but
how many crew does this plane use?
The crew has it consists of two pilots and one loadmaster, which makes it for a very challenging crew day.
I'll tell you. We're going to go inside the plane. Maybe as we get inside, you could tell us a little bit about the inside and how the cargo space and all that.
Oh, absolutely.
Inside the C-17, this is not quite as big as I thought it would be, but then when you said that an aircraft of this type transported Keiko the whale to Iceland from Oregon, it's a big plane. How much cargo can this actually hold?
Well, probably the biggest question that people ask is how many tanks it can hold. And right now, the Abrams M1A1 is the main battle tank that we currently carry around, weighing in at around 72 tons, 144,000 pounds, and we can carry one of those.
Keiko don't weigh anywhere near that.
Not anywhere near that, no.
I understand on landing in Iceland, they blew a few tires. Or is that because of his weight?
No, mostly because of the runway is composed of volcanic ash, you know, the volcanic rock like you use in your grill. So it's very coarse and very abrasive. And probably the biggest guess is that when they hit, it kind of shredded one of the tires apart a little bit.
Can't find good runways anywhere in Iceland.
Yeah, well, it's a very, very porous runway.
Thank you. What you're seeing going by on the flight line right now is a C-130. And it is probably not all that high off the runway itself. We'll take you inside of one of these C-130s. Matter of fact, that's what you were in. You were in a C-130 just a little while ago, and that's one of them in flight, going probably a couple hundred feet off the runway. And it'll take a left turn and head out over and then maybe swing back again. Also going by here in the last few minutes have been the tank killers. Now, if you look at that C-130, look at the maneuverability of that aircraft. It just takes those tight turns and heads up. It's a very sturdy aircraft. As Captain Walker said, the plane has seen a lot of action. It's been around since Vietnam, so they certainly know the limitations on this aircraft. That is the C-130 in flight.
As the C-130 Hercules of the Rhode Island National Guard comes by, jet engines, driving geared propellers. Put your cameras on and get a picture as the F-15 Eagle comes by in a slow speed pass.
Watch your head is on.
It's coming by at a normal pattern approach speed, coming up initial approach and then full afterburner power to climb up to the downwind. Now we see full power coming on. Landing gear being retracted from this approach to a landing, a low approach, quickly accelerating, holding the aircraft down to accelerate more rapidly. Nice steep pull-up for the closed driving pattern. Looking up the tailpipes, you could see the orange plume coming from the twin tailpipes, the Pratt & Whitney engines, providing over 50,000 pounds of thrust. The A-10 Thunderbolt II, built by Fairchild Republic, with twin General Electric TF-34 turbofan engines, with about 9,000 pounds thrust each. Aircraft having a top speed of nearly 500 miles an hour, about 450 knots. The tank killer, what a machine that proved to be during the Gulf War. It carries an Avenger 30mm 7-barrel Gatling gun with up to 16,000 pounds of various ordnances on 11 hardpoints. From 500-pound bombs to 2,000-pound bombs with Maverick missiles and laser-guided smart bombs. He's going to pull back on the throttle. Full opposite rudder brings the nose down as he exits off to air show right. Give him a great big round of applause. That's the way to start the morning. Sean D. Tucker and a 1-800-COLLECT. Challenger 2, he's going to take a very, very brief moment to climb up, and then he's going to begin a few of the maneuvers you're going to see him perform in our full show this afternoon. And then Sean is going to come back and work on a few individual maneuvers just to try and make them a little more precise this afternoon. We'll try to explain what he's doing as he's going through it. But right now he's climbing up 2,400 feet onto his back. The nose comes down. Let's watch for the smoke to come on. The airspeed is building up. A series of rolls on the way down, trading that altitude for airspeed. Once he sees 245 miles an hour on that airspeed indicator, he'll pull to level, pitch the nose up, This begins a maneuver which we call the Son of Edwin. It starts with a seemingly out-of-control tumble known as the Lomshabot. But watch as Sean stops it with the nose pointed perfectly vertical, converting this instantly into a precision balancing act. Right now, shifting into reverse, he is going to fly this aircraft tail first, looking for negative air speeds of 90 miles an hour at a distance of well over 400 feet. And only when he's ready will he let that nose fall down through the horizon with a surge of snap roll. Coming off over to air show right, leveling it off 25 feet above the ground. That airspeed coming up one more time. Watch as the nose comes up. Point roll. Right there on his back, he pulls the nose through the horizon. Watch for the quick half roll, then a series of inside diving snap rolls. Stopping the rolls right there, he's going to then bring it on down to 10 feet above the ground. The nose coming up for what we call the spiraling tower. It's 2.5 outside snap rolls on the way up. With the nose pointed off to air show right, he comes through the horizon. Watch for the quick 1.5 outside snap roll, ending Sean inverted. And actually, he's going to throw in a twist there. Coming out of that upright, he's going to bring it on down one more time, 5 feet above the ground. Nose coming up one more time. This is called a double hammerhead. It starts with a quarter roll, then a shoulder roll at very low airspeed. Watch as he performs not one, but two consecutive hammerhead turnarounds. A maneuver performed only in the world today by that man, Mr. Sean D. Tucker. Air show right, that nose comes up one more time. We call this the Tucker Upper. Coming out of that inverted, he continues to pull that stick through the horizon, driving it hard back to air show center. And in just a few moments, Sean is going to show you another maneuver. It's called a torque roll, and Sean's going to explain what he's doing as he goes through it. But right now, he's going to show you another double hammerhead. This is technically one of the most difficult maneuvers that Sean's doing this afternoon. So you'll see he's going to work on it several times. Sean, that second double hammerhead looked a lot better than the first. We didn't torque off there. Looks like we're getting back to the corner. Good practice.
All right, guys, let's go.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, watch closely. This is the world's smallest inside loop. We call this the alley loop. On the way down, he'll do a quick half roll, push off the bottom side, experiencing 5 negative Gs as he bottoms out of this maneuver. He pulls it right immediately into the Tucker Upper. He's going to then
come on down and just work on a couple of passes, not low for my ribbon cuts.
Okay, Sean, we'll be looking for the low passes on the ribbon cuts, and Air Boss has asked that you give us the 3-minute warning.
Okay, that'll be good.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, low and to your right, Sean is going to simulate now for us a maneuver you're going to see him perform later today. This is what we call the triple ribbon cut, right there in right knife edge flight. Immediately the left knife edge flight, and then to invert it. Ladies and gentlemen, I mentioned earlier, Sean is going to perform the torque roll maneuver. He's setting up for that right now. As I will try to finish up describing that triple ribbon cut you just saw Sean perform. This afternoon, we're going to have volunteers out there holding 3 ribbons over that show line. They're 20 feet above the ground, and Sean is going to cut all 3 of those maneuvers in those 3 orientations you saw. Right knife edge, right knife, left knife edge, and then invert it. But watch closely now, that 380 horsepower Lycoming engine pulling the 1-800 Collect Challenger 2 skyward at approximately 1,300 feet. His forward speed goes to 0, and now he is going to bring this aircraft down tail first. He's looking for negative air speeds in excess of 90 miles an hour. And just like the first time, he's going to fly this aircraft over 400 feet tail first. And he is, in fact, in control at all times. As he comes out of that maneuver, he is now going to show you what we call the kicker. It's a maneuver that we are probably going to put into our full air show sequence next season, tumbling end over end as Sean has the controls stuck in the corner. And he wanted me to get the crowd's response. Do you think we should put the kicker in our full show? Let's hear it, ladies and gentlemen. And another couple of tumbles off the end. I think Sean is going to be setting up for a landing very soon now.
You're looking at the C-5 Galaxy. This is the biggest aircraft that the Air Force is flying, and the Air Force Reserve is flying, and it is one of the biggest attractions here at the Great New England Air Show. Now, this has got an incredible payload capability. This gigantic C-5 Galaxy is in really outsized cargo transport, and its design is to provide the Air Mobility Command inter-theater airlift in support of the United States Air National Defense. Now, the C-5 you're looking at here is the largest aircraft in the world. It can carry outsized cargo intercontinental ranges and can take off or land in relatively short distances. In fact, ground crews can load and offload the C-5 simultaneously at the front and rear cargo openings. You're looking at the front rear cargo opening here. It can also kneel down to facilitate loading directly from a truck bed levels. And other features of the C-5 are high flotation landing gear with 28 wheels sharing the weight load. A full-width drive-on ramps at each end for loading double rows of vehicles. An automatic troubleshooting system that records and analyzes information and even detects malfunctions in more than 800 test points in this aircraft. And this plane, the C-5 Galaxy, is able to take off fully loaded with 8,300 feet of runway and land within 4,900 feet. And this particular C-5 Galaxy is similar in appearance to the smaller transport aircraft. And sometimes when you're driving by Westover Air Reserve Base, you do see one or the other. And the smaller one is the C-41 Starlifter. But the C-5, of course, is the granddaddy of them all. Both aircraft have that distinctive high tail wing, 25-degree wing sweep, and four turbofan engines mounted on pylons right beneath the wings. And the Galaxy carries nearly all of the Army's combat equipment, including the such heavy oversized items as its 74-ton, they even carry 74-ton mobile scissors bridge. They carry a whole bridge. It's amazing. This particular aircraft has 41,000 pounds of thrust per engine. Now, if you can stop and think about how aircraft were flying by a little while ago, they were carrying about 41,000 pounds of thrust per engine. There's four of them on here, and the wingspan is 222.9 feet. The length of the entire plane, 247 feet. The height of the aircraft, now this is at the tail, when you're looking at the tail, the height of the aircraft is 65.1 feet. Again, it carries, it has a range of 6,300 nautical miles and a crew of seven, usually a pilot, co-pilot, a couple of flight engineers, and three loadmasters. And this plane first became operational in June of 1970. You can no longer buy a C-5 Galaxy. They're out of, it says here on my information sheet, the inventory unavailable. So what you see is what you get. And all, there's 50 C-5Bs are scheduled to remain in active duty force shared by comparably sized and collected Air Force Reserve associated units. It's an amazing aircraft, and we're going to take you inside the aircraft to show you just how big this thing is. Now, we told you all about the aircraft from the information sheet that was given to us when we came in, but right now we're standing inside the C-5 Galaxy with Sergeant Jim Weldon. Hi there.
Hi, how you doing?
This is an aircraft. Now, I've been on 747s before, and I think a lot of people have flown those. If we were to compare a 747 with a C-5 Galaxy, what would be the big comparison in size?
What we call outsized cargo. The 747 will actually carry more cargo weight, but you can't open it up and drive a tank inside of a 747 or drive trucks inside. Or we carry what we call a lot of outsized cargo. That would be the major difference.
Okay, but the 747 is then an incomparable size to this thing?
Yes. Yeah, comparable size, comparable payload, but the type of payload varies.
You know, this particular aircraft came from where? Air Force Base.
This one here is from right here at Westover. We're based right here at Westover.
A lot of people make the mistake between this and a smaller version of this that you see flying around the Westover area. And when you get it on the ground, this thing's a whole lot bigger.
Yes, it is. Yeah, the smaller ones is the other ones similar is would be the C-141, which is carry about half, roughly about half payload as this one here.
Now, if you decided, if the government decided they were going to fly troops, say, to a problem area around the world, how many troops can they put in here?
We have a passenger cabin up in the rear of the aircraft that'll carry with a capacity for 75 troops. We also have a pallet, seat pallet, that will roll into the cargo box of the airplane here to carry another 270 passengers, but not very likely to do so. We do it very rarely.
They would go by other means.
Yes. Yeah, they charter out a 747.
Besides, flying in this particular plane as a passenger is probably not the biggest thrill in the world anyway.
Actually, it's not that bad. It's very comfortable, actually. And not as quiet, and you don't get the service in the movie, but it's really very comfortable.
No movie?
No movie.
Oh, you gotta do something about that. Well, now, you're a loadmaster with it.
Yes, I am.
Okay, now, a loadmaster does what?
I'm responsible for the weight and balance of the airplane, the cargo onload and offload, supervising the cargo onload, offload, securing of the cargo, and then we figure the weight and balance with the fuel, the cargo, and pre-flight the airplane.
How much fuel can this thing hold?
About 320,000 pounds of fuel, all in the wings.
You know, it's amazing when you're watching this thing fly over Westover and fly over the Springfield area as you're doing shopping around here. You wonder how these things can actually stay up in the air.
They say if you get enough speed and enough wing area, it'll fly. It's no different. They figure the wing area and get enough speed, generate the lift, and go right up. It's an optical illusion because it looks like it's going a lot slower than it should be.
But it's really moving along.
Absolutely, moving right along. Takeoff speed of about maybe 130 knots, depending on how much it's loaded.
You may not know the answer to this, but the C-5 is the last of its kind as far as this size aircraft. But do you know if there's anything bigger or anything like it that will be produced sometime down the road?
They have nothing on the drawing board as yet. They've been looking recently at the difference between taking another airplane off the shelf and configuring it for to replace the C-5. But as far as I know, they're going to have it in service at least another 20 years. They're reconfiguring them to have them in service another 20 years at least. Ron Salavia, hi.
Hi, how you doing, Larry?
Good Air Force, the Air Force recruiter in Pittsfield, and
the reserve recruiter.
Reserve recruiter. I'm
right.
Sorry.
Rich Tangen is your Air Force recruiter, and he's running around here today and tomorrow too. So yeah. You might run into him. They're usually set up inside the main hangar, but here at the Westover Air Force Reserve Base, we're having a great day. The weather is beautiful, and we just want folks to know that we do need a lot of help out here. They can reach us by calling the Pittsfield office at 442-2650. And I go up there every Tuesday. And we have an 800 number, which they can call here at 1-800-257-1212.
You got those in your head.
It happens. It's part of the job.
We just happened to catch you over by the C-5 Galaxy, but have you been all over the base?
Oh, actually, I've got a booth right in here. We're giving stuff away. We're, talking to folks. We've had the Air Force Reserve Band here all week.
Yeah, they were playing some tunes out here. Well, there was a couple of guys.
Actually, they broke down into 7 different bands. And we've been playing throughout the area high schools and different communities. And I've been talking to folks that have seen the band and high school kids that we're running into and other folks that don't realize that they're of age to join the reserve. And it's just like a lot of fun.
What are the ages to join the reserve?
Well, if you've never been in before in the military of any sort, you have to be between 17 with parent consent and no more than 35.
35, that puts me over the limit.
But if you've been in the service before, what we do is we'll take your active service time, subtract that from your age, and now we have to get you under 40.
Okay, so
I gotta keep looking for someone, Larry.
Yeah, I guess so. Us over 50 types are out of luck, huh?
Unless you got more than 10 years service time.
No, I don't have that.
For example, I had a guy once who was at 13 years service time and he was 52 years old. I was able to put him in.
Get him in somewhere.
Into the reserve program because we were able to bring his age under 40. It's all for retirement because you have to have the 20 years to be able to retire.
Now, you know, when you're inside the C5 galaxy like this, you've got an office here today.
Right.
And this is really strange.
Actually, I got a big wide office here as you guys have been filming.
Now, as people come by and as they walk around the airbase here today and they experience all the planes and the excitement of this whole thing, and they see a lot of Air Force regulars and reserves. Yeah, does it heighten interest? Are they more apt to talk to you about it?
That's what we're hoping for. We're really believing that will lead to something. The main thought is that they're going to take this excitement home with them, read the material that they've collected, and actually give us a call.
It's a good life, the Air Force.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It really is. It's not a bad way to go. It'd be like putting out a car show on for those car enthusiasts.
Well, this is for planes, and not everybody gets to fly a plane, of course.
Right.
But being part of the team is something.
Oh, it is, because to keep one aircraft in the sky, all right, if Westover Air Force Base was here for one aircraft that had one person to fly it, we would still need the entire base to keep that one plane working, because you need an entire crew of maintenance people. Then you need an entire crew of medical people to make sure those maintenance people are taken care of. Then you need a full dining facility and recreational facility so that all those people, and just goes on and on and on.
They need a lot of people. You get the hint, gang?
And the thing is, with an Air Force base and the Air Reserve base here, it's like a small community. So any kind of job that you can think of in your Pittsfield area, all right, we have a relatable job on the base.
Something here to do.
Exactly.
They need you. They need you. They need you and your services to whatever. That's something from the village people.
Right.
You know, I'm going to let you get back to your, somebody said you would be in high places one day, and I guess you can't get much higher than a C5 cargo.
Well, unless you're on top of it.
No, thank you. Actually, I'd love to fly one of these things. It would be a hoot.
I can't promise you.
No. A walkthrough,
maybe,
perhaps.
Maybe one day we can get you down here during the week. We can get you inside the simulator.
I don't know.
If you crash, you won't hurt anything.
Thanks a lot. I've crashed before. I've crashed before in computer simulators. I'm no good at this. Ron Salapia, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Larry.
Good luck today.
Thanks. I hope you folks all had a good time. Enjoy the show and give us a yell.
All right. Look, we are getting ready for this plane to take off. Al, what's going on with this plane? What kind is it?
Right now, we've got an F-86 Sabre jet taxiing out. It's the plane that flew in the Korean War. It was so successful against the Russian MiGs. It's taxiing out now. It's an extremely loud airplane. And he's going to put on a show. The plane next to him is a Czechoslovakian-built L-39 Albatross. It was used by the Russian Air Force as a primary military trainer before they flew the MiGs.
This is the kind of plane that we've seen in a lot of World War II, not World War II, but Korean War movies.
The F-86 was made famous in the Korean War, and anytime you see any of those movies, you'll see a lot of F-86s.
Al, the Sabre jet is flying around the airport right now. He made a couple of passes already. What's he going to do now once he swings around and comes back?
Well, with most of the jets, what everybody wants to see is low, fast, and loud.
They like it like that, huh?
They like their jets. They like to waste some serious aviation flu. So he'll be coming around again from left to right. He's coming down now.
He looks like he's almost making it a landing approach now.
That's about as slow as that plane can go and still be in the air. He'll go right in front of the crowd. Probably wag his wings a little bit. There he goes. He'll power up. Landing gear comes up. And there he goes.
Okay, here comes that F-86 that was flying over us. We didn't get a chance to see it take off, but it's coming in here now. It is a very, very loud aircraft. In fact, we've got earplugs in, so we've got to get a little out of the way for this thing. But this is a close-up shot of one of the planes that was made famous during the Korean War. It's an absolute gorgeous aircraft. A Sabre jet. And he's all done.
This particular plane is a L-39 Albatross. It's a Czechoslovakian-built primary trainer that the Russians used. It's being flown today by Alan Smith. He also has a T-34 trainer, and he flew A-6s for United States Navy for a number of years. He's one of the hottest pilots at the show.
He seems a little embarrassed by that.
He's not embarrassed at all. He's just anxious to get up there and show us what he can do.
Let's go talk to him for a second. You mind if we talk to you for just a second?
Lieutenant. Minutes before engine
start. Thank you. Lieutenant Alan Smith, you're going to be flying the Attila.
Yeah, well, Attila is my call sign from the Navy.
So how do you like flying this plane?
It's a wonderful aircraft. It's designed and built by the Czechs for the Russians, and they used a lot of U.S. technology that they acquired during the Cold War. Flies like an A-4. Very simplistic. All the flight control services are direct push-pull. There's no hydraulics.
So when you go up in a couple of minutes, what exactly are you going to be doing in it?
It's called a flight demonstration. There'll be a non-aerobatic demonstration of the capability of the aircraft in terms of its tight turning radius, its high G-loading capability, and its close ground air support role. It's a multi-role fighter. They use it for a fighter with a 23 caliber chain gun. It also has, as you can see, it has hard points on the wings. They carry bombs and rockets, and it's also an advanced trainer.
This place is really alive today, you know?
It's shaking. That's an F-86 Sabre jet taking off.
Yeah, that was the one we saw over here. How much thrust does this thing have?
It's a 3,800-pound thrust jet engine, about a 2.5-to-1 weight-to-thrust ratio, which is excellent for performance.
You give them the crowd here today a nice thrill, come down low to the deck?
Yeah, they'll get the impression that I'm having a lot of fun. The name of the game today is for 14 minutes of slamming and jamming the aircraft and minimize the dead air time so they can really enjoy it.
Thank you. Lieutenant Alan Smith, thank you very much. Good luck up there.
See you later. Thank you.
He's got his chock blocks pulled. He'll taxi out and he'll put on a nice show too.
He seems like he's right at home right there.
You put a till in an airplane, he's right at home.
Yeah, he said that was his name, but he seems to be just, he'll have a great time. How many years has he been flying this particular plane again?
This is brand new. He just bought this plane a year ago for him.
He bought it?
He bought it and he rebuilt it. He's very, very proud of that.
Okay. Now that's an interesting sidelight. I didn't know he owned the plane. I thought it was maybe...
He owns his T-34 also. It's the exact same plane as on the other side. You want to walk over there later. So he's got two of them.
Nice hobby.
It is a hobby. He's got a full-time job. I think he's an insurance adjuster in the Philadelphia area. and this is his hobby.
Now you know what insurance adjusters do. Some of them on their weekends.
Well, hey, it's a great hobby. You come to a show like this, I don't mind paying my insurance premiums a few times.
No, not at all. That thing's going to get loud here in a couple of minutes.
It'll get a little louder, but nowhere near as loud as the modern military planes. If you're around in a couple of hours, when the F-15 takes off, an incredibly loud aircraft. But this is a trainer, so it doesn't have as much horsepower.
And then we can cut. We'll pick it up again when he starts moving. Okay, he's beginning to roll out now. He's going to roll left. Give him the thumbs up. Gives us the thumbs up as he gets set to go out there. CCCP, the Russian symbols. Now, we're right at the business end of that plane. I bet you we're going to get a little blast out of it.
We'll get a little bit, but not bad. Not bad at all. He's gone.
And he's on his way. We'll see him flying by here in a couple of minutes.
There he is. Nice and low. He's going to show you the bottom of the plane. Nice low pass. See how quiet that engine is? Right in front of Show Center. take it right up and bank to the left.
He's got this whole routine down pretty pat, though. I mean, he doesn't really do anything last minute out of the ordinary. Gee, I got a great idea.
Every pilot here, every flight has been rehearsed and practiced. The air traffic controllers know what they're going to do. The tower knows what they're going to do. There are no surprises.
Okay, we're going to get our own private little tour before everybody comes in. And I want to thank you, Al, for doing this for us.
Oh, this is great. I mean, this is what I'm here for. I was got a little bored there for a while. This is incredible.
We won't let you get bored, believe me.
This particular aircraft, American AT-6, it was the primary trainer in World War II for the World War II aircraft. The Navy used it. British used it. They call it the Harvard. This particular one is decorated in the Royal Canadian Air Force decorations. This plane's been around for over 50 years. There's still quite a few of them left.
Now, the one to the right of this plane is we're going to walk up the flight line here.
On the right is the aircraft that a pilot would have trained in the AT-6. This is a Corsair. This was developed late in World War II. It's a carrier-based World War II fighter. It was probably the premier piston fighter in the Pacific in World War II. It had the best kill ratio of any American naval aircraft.
I think it got a lot of television coverage when Baba Black Sheep was on the air with Robert Conrad.
Robert Conrad made that aircraft famous, or the other way around.
Or the other way around. No, because that was the plane he flew and the gang flew in that, and I think it got a lot of publicity.
It's a distinctive inverted gull wing, and the reason for that is that propeller is so huge, a straight wing on that aircraft, the landing gear, the propeller would touch, so by inverting the wing, it allows the landing gear to lift that aircraft up even higher to have that huge prop not touch the ground.
Wow. Okay.
World War II fighter. This one is obviously by the Shark's Mouth, was made famous. Flying Tiger in China. It made the P-40 the famous plane that it is today. Another American aircraft. Used early in World War II, the Americans, Britain ordered quite a few of these. There's only a few of them around that still fly. This one's just absolutely gorgeous.
Who owns this plane?
I'm not sure who owns this plane, but whoever it is, he's rich and lucky.
Probably looks at a Corvette like, who needs that?
Aircraft on our right is another AT-6, exactly the same as the first one. Again, it was the primary trainer for World War II.
And as we swing around over here to the right, here we have a T-34 Warbird.
It's a T-34 Mentor. This is a 50, late 50 vintage aircraft. Again, it was a primary trainer for the military, fully acrobatic, retracting landing gear. It's got about a 200 horsepower engine in there, made by Beechcraft, I believe. And again, it was primary trainer. That aircraft, again, is 40 or 45 years old also. Another very nice airplane.
Okay, now here's a plane that we've all seen in the movies a lot, an awful lot, the C-47.
This particular plane is the C-47. It originated Douglas Aircraft, DC-3. It's what really made commercial airlines possible for flying. This one's all decked out in the Normandy invasion stripes. You can see the black and white stripes on it. It was used for cargo. It was used to drop paratroopers. It was used to tow gliders. Used just about anything. There's still quite a few of these things around.
And it's still being used. It's still being used commercially, too.
Yes, it is. In some areas, especially South America, these planes are actually in use ferrying people and cargo still. They're an incredible aircraft. We have two of them here. We have another one in the United States Air Force colors. If you could pan over there to your left.
There it is way down there. We'll take a closer look at that in a moment. I know down at the Air Museum on the other side of Bradley International, they have a DC-3 sitting inside, and it's the passenger version with all the seats.
Yes. I think it carried about 21 passengers. They speed about 250 miles an hour. Certainly nothing compared to today's jets, but it's an absolute classic, an absolute beauty, and everyone has seen them on many, many movies. And
oh, yeah. Well, Terry and the Pirates was another one. He made quite a few motion pictures about that. Using this airplane.
That's just a gorgeous, gorgeous airplane.
Now, the next one down, this is a little bit different. This is a little bit different plane. What is this one?
This is not a cargo plane. This is the famous Mitchell B-25. It is certainly famous for the Doolittle raid on Tokyo, when 16 of these took off aircraft carrier Hornet and made that surprise raid in World War II. This aircraft is 50-something years old. There's only a few of these flying, and you can see it's, they still have the ball turrets on and the machine guns and the nose art and everything, and there's only a few of these still flying.
I remember the movie where they were training these things to go a certain length to get off an aircraft carrier. They were training down in Florida, and then when they finally got them on the carriers, the famous pictures there where they're taking off, and boy, you wondered how they did it.
Yep, they had that aircraft carrier going as fast as it could to get a good headwind, and they'd rev up the engines, release the brakes, and off they went a couple of hundred feet. It's a medium bomber. It was used in Germany and the Pacific, all over. It's an incredibly stable aircraft, very loud aircraft. This is by far one of the most famous aircraft in the world. It's the Boeing B-17. It was made in the late 1930s. And it made daytime precision bombing over Germany in World War II a reality. As you can see by the nose art, this one's called the Fuddy Duddy. I believe there's less than a dozen of these aircraft still fly. We were very, very excited to have one here at Westover. It's known the Fortress because it was made extremely sturdy, and it has over 12 50 caliber machine guns to give itself protection. The thought was these massed in group with all the defensive firepower that they would be able to fight off the German fighters. I'm not sure that was completely successful, and many of them, of course, were lost during the war, but clearly this is one of the most famous aircrafts ever, World War II.
I know the our Berkshire viewers are familiar with this plane because not this particular B-17, but a B-17 with the Collings Foundation, and a B-24 fly into Pittsfield and go on display. Well, they've been coming back the last couple of years, drawing a real nice crowd, and they take people up in these things, which is the amazing thing.
Well, that'd be great. If anybody ever have an opportunity to get a ride in one of these vintage aircrafts, you should certainly take that opportunity. But not too many people are lucky enough to get that invitation.
I know. Last year
I haven't gotten one.
Well, last year I had the opportunity to fly from Springfield, Vermont, to Pittsfield in the B-24, which is a different aircraft. And I'll tell you something. And people said, "Oh, what a rough ride!" It was the smoothest takeoff and landing I have ever had. And I fly a lot, so this was quite an aircraft. But the B-17 you're looking at here, folks, is a vintage aircraft, and it's one that, like you said, there's not too many of these left.
No, there's not, and she's a beauty. She just came down. She'll be taking off tomorrow. Crew's relaxing a little bit right now. They got the bomb bay doors open, and just hope that a couple of minutes will let the fans come in here. Everybody get a chance to look up close.
From Colorado Springs, Colorado, Lieutenant Colonel Brian Bishop. Flying left wing from Woodland Hills, California, is Captain Brad Bartell. Flying the right wing from Louisville, Kentucky, is Major Rob Gibbons. With family in the audience watching today, flying the slot position from San Antonio, Texas, Major Paul Krause. Flying lead solo from Houston, Texas, is Major Mark Arlinghouse. And flying the opposing solo from St. Louis, Missouri, is Major Dennis Mouthfer. Today, the Thunderbird mission is to demonstrate the result of teamwork, dedication, and the professionalism found in your Air Force. So let's begin the flying demonstration. See them smoothly transition back into the diamond.
Lose them up there.
Parked in the center of the five card is our slot pilot, Major Paul Kraus. This is precision flying at its finest. There's no room for error here in the center of the five card. Ladies and gentlemen, dedicated to the United States Air Force Reserve, your 1998 Thunderbird Delta pass in review. Direction, then pull through to meet at show center, then back into the vertical for aileron roll. Ladies and gentlemen, as the Thunderbirds touch down to end another exciting demonstration, it's time to recognize those young men and women who make it happen, the support and maintenance professionals who keep us flying. There are almost 140 people on the Thunderbird team. While only 8 of us fly, the heart of the team is that large group of people who don't fly, people of all ranks and skills, true team players, with no one more or less important than the other. Unassuming Americans who work hard to put quality into the mission, and their efforts get results. Thunderbirds have been showing Americans what our Air Force can do for 45 years now. And during all that time, not a single demonstration has been canceled due to a maintenance problem. I'm now going to introduce you to some of the maintenance and support personnel whose commitment to quality helped to keep that record intact. In the center is our line chief, Master Sergeant Jeff Maurer from Pottstown, Pennsylvania.
Crew Chief, Thunderbird number one, Staff Sergeant Dwight Andreessen from Comanche, Iowa. Assistant Crew Chief, Thunderbird number one, Staff Sergeant Jerry White from Stowe, Ohio. Crew Chief, Thunderbird number two, Staff Sergeant Kevin Charette from Warren, North Carolina. Assistant Crew Chief, Thunderbird number two, Staff Sergeant Gene Neely from Westwood, New Jersey. Crew Chief, Thunderbird number three, Staff Sergeant Scott Baker from Coleman, Michigan. Assistant Crew Chief, Thunderbird number three, Staff Sergeant John Riles from Charleston, South Carolina. Crew Chief, Thunderbird number four, Staff Sergeant Scooter Clark from Ocala, Georgia. Assistant Crew Chief, Thunderbird number four, Staff Sergeant Charles Bostick from Wheeling, West Virginia. Crew Chief, Thunderbird number five, Staff Sergeant Paul Schultz from Redwood Falls, Minnesota.
Thank you for watching the first edition of Kratka's Corner for the brand new 1998-99 season here on Pittsfield Community Television, Channel 9. The Great New England Air Show was a lot of fun to go to, and I hope you had a lot of fun watching it. I'd like to ask you if you'd like to volunteer to work on any of the shows here on Channel 9, to please get a hold of us at 445-4234. You can work on Kratka's Corner, this show, or you could work on Speak Out Berkshires or any of the other programs that take place here. Ask for Anita or Karen, and either one will be more than happy to help you in finding out if you really want to come down here and do this. In fact, if you'd like to come down and watch a Kratka's Corner in production, we usually do the show live the first and third Wednesday of every month, so you're more than welcome to come down for that, but please call ahead so we know you're coming. But once again, if you'd like to volunteer to work on any of the shows here on Pittsfield Community Television, Channel 9, give Anita or Karen a call at 445-4234. We've got a lot of shows planned for Kratka's Corner in the upcoming months ahead, some of which are going to be political, some of which are going to be an awful lot of fun, and yes, we're going to put together another cooking show. The others we did were so popular, we just have to do it again. So we'll have to get out our skillets and our fry pans, and we'll cook something up, but that's later in the season. So we hope you enjoyed this very first edition of Kratka's Corner right here on Pittsfield Community Television, Channel 9. Take care.